All right. Hi, everyone. I would like to welcome you to Arts on the Block's last public block talk of 2020. Hooray. Today we have two very special guests, Imar Hutchins and John Ortiz, whom I'll be introducing here in just a moment. I'd like to let you guys know there's going to be a moment for questions and answers right after each talk. So if you could please hold your questions until after each talk, there'll be a moment to ask questions to both Imar and John. I was very happy and I'm very happy to have John and Imar here today. They're good friends of mine, and we all share private studios over at Pyramid Atlantic, and that's how I met John and Imar in the first place. So thanks so much for coming here today.
Of course.
First, I'd like to introduce Imar. Imar Hutchins is a self-taught artist based here in Washington, D.C. He works primarily in collage and printmaking. Imar's portraits combine vintage black magazines, hate mail, and other historical documents, as well as found objects, tissue paper, and new materials. He imagines that people themselves are collages, amalgams of countless disparate fragments and inputs. He remixes his subjects in new and often Afro-futuristic ways, but always drawing from or challenging historical notion. Imar, thank you so much for joining us today.
Oh, absolutely. It's great to be here. And you guys started a few minutes early. You know, I wasn't ready for that. But but thanks so much to Melissa, and everyone at Arts on the Block for organizing this. I wonder if we should, we said 3:30. I wonder if we should wait until 3:30.
We can maybe wait a few minutes if you want to. It seems like some of the people who are attending are having a little bit of trouble or taking some time to get into the room from what Athena said in the chat.
Yeah, let's hang out here for a minute.
Imar, I can reintroduce you.
Probably because if we told people 3:30, we shouldn't start at 3:26, you know?
Yeah, very true.
But yeah, not to say that more people will or won't join, but just to, you know, stick to the plan.
I bet they will jump in here with us. I see we've got Michael here with us. Hi, Michael.
Hello, how are you?
Doing okay. Happy Friday.
Same to you.
Steen just joined us. Yeah, we do have a couple folks jumping in.
There was a registration feature put on this meeting, so my guess is we might have some late arrivers. So.
I bet you folks are registering right now. Looks like Juanita's here with us. Hi, Christine. It's funny, Melissa, on my screen, there's a bunch of screens that come up that say your name.
I'm seeing that too.
Yeah.
Yep. So I think something about our Zoom call is naming people you before they join in.
Oh, that's funny.
Must be a shared account or something like that. It depends on what login you're using.
Okay.
But the moderator can change their name. You just click on them in the other participants window. I'm an old hand at Zoom.
We're all learning it, aren't we?
Yeah,
boy, who knew that we were all going to be Zoom experts in 2020? I see Nancy Saucer. Hello, Nancy.
Hello.
Nice to see you.
Yeah, glad to be here.
Okay, it's 4:30, so you can you can start now.
All right, thank you. So I'm going to just say a few words again for some folks who were here a little early. I'd like to welcome everyone to Artists on the Block's last Block Talk of 2020. Sounds like someone needs to mute.
Someone has an open mic.
Thank you. Today we have two very special guests, Imar Hutchins and John Ortiz, whom I'll be introducing in a moment. Imar and John and I all have private art studios at Pyramid Atlantic Art Center, which is how I met each one of these wonderful artists. And each of our talks will last around 45 minutes today. And there'll be a moment for you to ask questions to both Imar and John. If you could please hold your questions until after they speak, there'll be a good 15 or 20 minutes to pose questions. And you can pose your questions in both chat or open up your mic at that time. So at this moment, I'd like to introduce Imar Hutchins. Imar is a self-taught artist based here in Washington, D.C. He works primarily in collage and printmaking. Imar's portraits combine vintage black magazines, hate mail, and other historical documents, as well as found objects, tissue paper, and new materials. He imagines that people themselves are collages, amalgams of countless disparate fragments and inputs. He remixes his subjects in new and often Afrofuturistic ways, but always drawing from or challenging a historical notion. So again, we'd like to welcome Imar to today's talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Melissa. Thanks so much for organizing this event. And thanks to everyone at Arts on the Block. You know, I've heard so much about you that it's a pleasure to meet you in person, and how great to meet you with so many friends and family I see joining the conversation. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go through a little presentation that I prepared for today that will tell you about my practice in general, but I think I'm also gonna, I may deviate a little bit from it because I wanna talk about things that are more specific to the kind of mission of your organization and the young people that you work with. So can everybody see my screen right now?
Yeah, we can see it. Thank you.
Okay, good. What we have here is some of my influences. You have David Driscoll there on the left. You have Romare Bearden at the top. You have Jacob Lawrence in the bottom center. And then you have my grandfather there on the bottom right corner. And, you know, I gave a presentation last night for the Phillips collection, and I talked about how these three people are good examples of the kind of DNA that at least is influencing me as an artist and my work. And I have, you know, I can talk for an hour about any single slide on this deck. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and go through it more quickly so that we have time for Q&A at the end and we still stick to our schedule. So this picture here is of a one-room schoolhouse in Columbia, Tennessee that my ancestors started back in the 1840s. And that's my ancestor there on the left side. And it was a school called the College Hill School, which is actually still standing. It's now a public school. I mean, it's a modern, it doesn't look like that anymore, but the same school is still going and it's part of the public school system there in Columbia, Tennessee. And as I said, I could talk about it for an hour. What I'll just say is that One of my forebears was known as the rifle-toting teacher. So it was such a crime and so dangerous to teach Black people at that time that he always taught with the rifle on the desk in front of him. And he, everywhere he went, he carried the rifle with him. So this is the kind of threat that that they were under in those times. And as we go on, we'll see how I think that some of that is influences my work today. So some of you may have seen a show that was locally here at Pyramid Atlantic in late last year, and then was at the Muhammad Ali Center in Louisville, Kentucky in the beginning of this year. And well, actually, as you can see by the dates there, it was cut short by the pandemic. And I think it was quite, you know, fortuitous that it was in Kentucky, in Louisville at that time. One side of my family is from there. And my parents live there now. And it coincided with almost exactly the onset of the pandemic and the killing of Breonna Taylor. And I'm going to talk about that more as we go on, but I'll just say that this is the cover image from the Inheritance body of work, and it is called Day of Absence. It's a picture of my mom who was acting in a play called Day of Absence that some of you might have heard of. It's a play about an imaginary day when all the Black people disappeared and what happened to America on that day. So here's a installation view of the show. On the right, there is a portrait of my grandfather that, if we have time, we'll talk about a little bit more later. In case we don't, I will just say that these are kind of emblematic of my work. So most of what I do is collage. I would say 75% collage. And I do about 25% printmaking as well. And the collage work is these large scale collages. These are 6 feet tall in this case. That's the size I'm working at right now. And they're composed of old Ebony magazines from the 60s, historical documents, hate mail, ephemera, found objects. And so the one of my grandfather, which we will have time to talk about more later, even though from a distance it looks rather uplifting, and it is uplifting, I think, when you get close to it, you can see that it's made up of hate mail and death threats that he got. Some of the most hateful things that you could imagine. So I'll keep going. This is another installation view of that show. There's the reference for that portrait that we started talking about. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna try to kind of dissect a couple of them as we go through. First, I'm going to talk about more of the printmaking, then I'm going to talk about the collage. I'm actually going to give you a little bit of the background of this one before digging into the printmaking. So usually it starts with this. And in this case, what I was trying to do is to capture some hard, indescribable quality about a person, right? We already know what they look like. So what I'm always trying to do is to figure out what do they feel like. And if I were gonna be like hyper realistic, of course we can render the person, but that's not really the goal. The goal for me is like to simplify it down and somehow still convey. And so I think that's what happened with the sketch and then, or the study, and then it's another separate challenge to scale that and then to turn it into one of the collage pieces. when we talk about influences, this is starting to tell you about my practice. So Zoma, who curated the show, likes to show this picture because it's obviously a riff on American Gothic, and it's obviously a modernist type of composition and whatnot, but it also shows kind of like the antecedents of my work, right? What inspired my work, you know, before I was even born. And so my first foray, well, maybe not my first, but my first real foray into art was to be an editorial cartoonist. And I was an editorial cartoonist for a paper in Philadelphia called the Tribune, which was the Black newspaper in the city. And no one knew it was a kid doing the cartoons, okay? And then one day, I was about 14 to 16 at this time. And then one day they ran my picture under the cartoon. And then all the kids in school were like, I didn't know you do the cartoons. Oh, yeah, I do the cartoons. So, you know, the point that I would make if I were talking to young people is that, you know, it's basically you're never too young to be an artist. You know, the more I know about art and artists, what I would say is that there is no right way to be an artist. You know, there is no correct way. You know, if you're doing it the so-called correct way, it's probably not going to work anyway. You know, everyone has their own path, and my path involved being an editorial cartoonist when I was a teenager. You know, Bearden was also a cartoonist, and most people don't know that. This is some of the archives that I have. So I have a really good, almost museum worthy archives of movement memorabilia and things like that. So, you know, my parents were in the civil rights movement and kept a lot of stuff. And you can see there is my father's writing collage on that folder that he wrote on that folder before I was even born. And I don't know that he made a collage out of it, or certainly not all of it, but there was the seed was planted somehow back then. These are just a couple of examples of the kind of things that might appear in my archives, things I might gravitate to. I could talk about this for an hour, but I would just say that here's a guy with a rope around the neck of his own kid. This is a protest against drugs in the community. So there was no, you know, these are a lot of what you're gonna see. A common thread is just self-determination. Like, they were not waiting for someone to come fix the problem. We didn't have that choice. Right. And I could talk more, but let me keep going. So I'm really heavily influenced by printmakers, and I love especially Cuban and Puerto Rican printmakers. This is one of my favorites. This is a guy named Rafael Morante. This is a homage to George Jackson. You know, if you don't know who he is, that's another hour. But he was a freedom fighter who was killed. And so what I want to point out here is that, you know, the simplicity of the kind of work that needs to be on a poster for it to be effective, you know, I think is a recurring theme in my work. Because if you're passing it on the street, then it if it doesn't speak to you in that second, then you never even saw it, right? So I think that my work always has some type of iconographic, you know, aspect to it. And it also may be that I used to be a street artist on West Broadway in Soho. That might be a factor too, the fact that, you know, I'm just used to people reacting or not reacting in a second, you know? And this is a video of Fight the Power by Public Enemy, and I'm gonna play just a second of that for you all.
Playback.
And I'm going to let it keep playing while I talk. So this is staged as a political convention, right? You have these signs from every locality where Black people are, like they've sent their delegation, and now they're going to, you know, decide what they're going to do, right? But the common thread in that Zoma really pointed out in the talk last night was art in this, basically protest art, and how it's art in the service of protest or resistance. And so what I want you to think about is that if you take away the all the signs for all the different places, you take away the poster of Malcolm X behind him, the logo of Public Enemy, the picture of Paul Robeson there, and Joe Lewis there. If you take away all that, you just have people in the street, right? So what we're looking at is kind of like an overlapping where, you know, art forms are crossing over. You know, the one that I showed you of the guy with the rope around his own kid's neck, that could be considered performance art, you know, and this is music and singing and filmmaking, you know, and graphic art, you know, all combined, right? And so what we want to do is stop looking at things so narrowly and start to understand them as, you know, more parts of a whole, right? These different media collaborate or work together. And I'm gonna close this. 1 second, and I'm gonna share something else with you. I told you I was going to deviate from the plan a little bit. I'll take that license to do it. I want to talk about how my...
Mel? Coming down.
Someone's mic is open here. What I want to do is talk about how, where I see my work fitting into that tradition. Right, here's a print that I was talking about last night with Phillips, which I did for a show, which is actually still going there until January 3rd, called Rifts and Relations. And then on the left side is my Kaepernick portrait. And it's part of a body of work called Sacred Cows. And this was a show that you may have seen. It was at the Prince George's African American Museum. And the premise of the show was that Black people's continued existence is such a miracle in and of itself that we should be like sacred cows in America. You know, so you know how in certain places like India and Africa, cows are sacred. Well, what if when a Black person walked into a Starbucks, people got up and said, oh, let me take my seat, let me get you some coffee, you know? Or what if when one sat down in the street, traffic just went around, you know? So it's really just a way of flipping the conception, right? And what you'll see is horns, like if you look at Kaepernick's afro there, there's horns in the afro. And you probably can't see my cursor, but if you look at look at his temples, and then you can see two horns. Can you see them?
Yeah, and we can see your cursor also.
Oh, you can. That works. Okay, that's fancy. Okay. Yeah, so I'm kind of highlighting the horns for you guys. So basically, it's a kind of a recurring theme in some of my work. This adornment. The horns may reappear, and I'll show you. Usually I do about four or five big pieces a year in one print. This year, just the way it worked out, I've done a lot of printmaking. And so these are two protest prints that I did this year, and with the help of a number of great printmakers at Pyramid Atlantic who worked with me on them. And Melissa, of course, is one of them, and she helps me in so many ways at the studio, just keeping everything together on track. So on the left, Justice for Queen Brianna, this was following the same kind of conception. So if you look at her crown, you'll see she has horns. You see, there's horns in the crown. And the impetus was that everyone knows the case. The impetus for it was to say, okay, here's a person who's been shot like a dog, right? Well, what is the opposite of that, right? What if this were the queen and someone went into the Buckingham Palace and shot her in her sleep, you know? Like, what would the outrage be? And so this is a thought exercise for us, right? And it's something that could only be given away. It was not for sale, and it was given away mainly for protest actions in Louisville, but also I made it freely downloadable on my website. And so it ended up being used, still being used everywhere around the world, really. And then I was inspired to do this one on the right, which is, this is Justicia para Jaina Marielle. And that's Justice for Queen Marielle in Portuguese. And she was a Afro-Brazilian Rio City Council person, activist for the rights of the poor people there, for LGBT rights, for the Afro-Brazilian rights, and she was murdered in 2018. And turns out 2 years, almost to the day before Breonna Taylor was killed. So these we sent to Brazil, and her family is selling them to support the institute there in her name. And we also sent Brianna's to Brazil and Marielle's to Louisville. So just quickly going through it. The next body of work I did was called Chattel, and there's Muhammad Ali, young Muhammad Ali. And you'll see that he has, you'll note the pointy ears, and if you look in his hair, you can see the horns again. You see that? And this was for a show called Chattel on Martha's Vineyard in 2018. And I'll just keep going quickly so I have a chance to go through everything. This is a piece called Dolan, which was in that Sacred Cow's body of work. And the reason I want to show is that because I have a quick little video that kind of shows you my process. Can you guys see that okay? So this is my process. I was working at a smaller size back then than I do now, but this is the way the piece kind of takes shape in terms of, you know, over time, using different color papers, newspapers, magazines, clippings, etc. And you know, I the people like the time lapses because it kind of it shows you how it came to be. You know, if you saw my post today, one of my goals was to demystify art with this talk. And I don't know if I'm gonna do it, but it's always one of my goals because I feel like art belongs to the people, right? I don't feel like it's something that is owned or controlled or should be anyway by any handful of people or institutions. We have a bunch of kids here right now and give them some markers and they're gonna start creating art, you know? And you can see it taking shape. You know, usually the line work, well, sometimes they don't have any line work at all, but in this case, the line work, it's also collage, it kind of looks like painting, but it's also collage. And that's usually the last thing that I'll add to the piece. And you can see it. I'll just keep going here. This is showing the kind of hate mail that appears in the work. That's a self-portrait from that same show. And there is a portrait of my father in the middle, who I think is on the call. And I think I checked the list. So I'm also included this to try and show you process. So it usually starts with a sketch and then color studies and figuring out the palette that I want to use. And so this is Marcus Garvey. What I'll just say about this one is that he actually, if you Google him, you'll always Google a color picture of Garvey, and he's always got a blue uniform on. It's actually a mistake. These are colorized photos and people copying each other making the same mistake. He actually wore a purple suit and purple and gold. And so I said, okay, he's Jamaican. He wears a purple and gold suit. He's a colorful person, right? No one wears a purple suit that's not colorful. So what I did was kind of depicted him in these kind of festive colors, yet with that same stern look that we've seen from that Van Der Zee photo. And I would say, like, research is a big part of my work. I usually study people for like a year before I do them. This is a Toussaint portrait that I did, and you know, it started, so sometimes it starts small and goes big. So this started with that the piece on the right, which is homage, obviously, to Jacob Lawrence. And then it ended up evolving and going big. And I think it was the first one I did in that size. And it's I think I have a detail of it here. Yeah. So this is good because you don't get to see, unless you're like close to the work, you won't get to really appreciate, you know, what they're like. You know, you can see it just generally. This is all about the sea. This piece is all about the sea, right? And it's about how they defeated the French. It's the only ever successful slave rebellion. We don't learn about it in school. But this is, I mean, we talked a lot about it yesterday because this here is actually a piece of a historic painting, you know, so there's various layers and levels to it. It's really like, it's an homage to two people, Chris Ofili in particular, Night and Day, and Bradford Young, my good friend, his mother of George. So in terms of the palette, that Indigo palette, that's what I was thinking of. And then it wasn't until later that I learned that Brad was reflecting Chris when he made Mother of George. So it's all like a circle. But I'll just kind of go through a couple of projects. This was Frederick Douglass. This is now, it's in the collection of the District of Columbia. And this is a special issue of Ebony. It was the 100th anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation, September 1963. So Ebony always had that red and white logo. There's only a couple that they didn't make it red and white. So Life magazine, if you can picture the logo, it was the same red and white. So it's as if to say Ebony was the, you know, the black version of Life. But on this issue, and also on the issue when King was killed, they didn't do it that way. As if to say, this is not the black version, something else. Like this is our stuff right here. And so you can see Frederick, he's got his horns coming in there. And then this is a detail of the work in progress. You know, the eyes coming in. And there is the completed work in another work in progress image. And notice the name of the piece is "What to the American Slave is Your 4th of July?" So note that he's red, white, and blue. And I could talk, as I said, I could talk about these things ad infinitum. I make my own frames, you know, mill the wood, stretch the canvas, mix my own paints. You know, it's kind of like a soup to nuts type of approach. Like I just want to have like ownership and control of everything. Like, so if you have one of my paintings and it falls off the wall, well, it's not because, oh man, they, you know, Blick is making those garbage frames now. No, it's because I messed up the frame and that's what happened, you know? Here's one that also I'll quickly go through because I'll show you going the other way from big to small, from collage to print. So this is Josephine Baker. You know, I studied her for like a year before I did this. I'll just say one thing, which is that she adopted 13 kids of every race and religion. And you can see the kids in her hair. If you look in her hair, the kids are there. Those are not literally the kids. They represent the kids. She's also a spy in the French Resistance. So that's where this military green comes from. And it's an homage to a poster that I could talk about more. I'll just say that it's the only poster from those days of her that focused on her face and not her body. And so then my process is to make a collage. But so look at them separately, they look the same, but when you look at them together, they're really quite different. I mean, there's no kids in the hair, it's just colors now, you know? And so it's really quite different. And then it moves into printmaking, which you may be familiar with. This is just a quick little video of me doing one of the layers of that. This looks like the last layer. So usually what you're doing is going from usually light to dark. For me, what I do is this goes analog. It always starts out analog. It goes analog, digital, and then back to analog. So I do the separations in computer. Separations is each layer of color is its own screen. And so you have to control where you want ink to go and where you don't. And where two colors meet, you've got to do something. So they're either there's either trapping or overprinting, and you have to figure out basically how every intersection of color is going to be. Look at the flat top that the screen is giving me there. For a while, they thought that was like my hairstyle up here, but then they realized that, no, it was just the screen's missing in my head so much, it's pushing it down. So they're in the rack. How am I doing on time? Am I okay?
Yeah, about 10 more minutes before Q&A.
Okay. So this is Simone Lee. If you don't know who she is, you can look her up. But I did a piece that's homage to her. And so it's interesting because it's the portrait of a sculpture. It's not even a portrait of a person. And so, but it does have the horns. You see that? And I'm going to go through it a little quickly. That was when it was in progress. These are progress photos. And then, oh. Well, I didn't show you the finished one, but I'll show you the finished one. We're going to keep going, but I'll come back and show you that. This is the one of my grandfather. There, I'm on the right, and the art guy is researching him at the University of Louisville. So he was the first Black student at the University of Kentucky, and he sued them to be admitted. So it was one of the cases that led up to the Brown decision. And so I was commissioned by the university to create this portrait of him that would go in a dorm that they named after him. And so that's the study. I studied him for like a year as if I didn't know anything about him, even though I did. And that's the finished piece as installed in the show at Pyramid. And so you can see, this is what I talked about briefly before. It's a kind of uplifting. It's called I Lived Half My Life in the Darkness and Half in the Light. But then when you get close to it, it's like the most hateful stuff you can imagine. You know, you can read it, but in the several thousand years of history, the Negro has never constructed an alphabet, created a literature or a science, produced any great men, or built any type of civilization. Out of the 21 great civilizations of the past, there's never been a Negro. You wonder why? So this one says the last great white hope, sickle cell anemia. And since my grandfather was such a dedicated note taker and collector, what they did is they didn't just send it to him, they sent it to all of his family and friends, and he documented what day they got it, you know. And I should say he got this mail up through the 90s when he died, so it's not ancient history. There's a portrait of Prince and I can say more about that. I won't. There's James Baldwin as installed at Pyramid, the print of James Baldwin. And I'm pushing to get through it so I can show you some things that aren't on the list. This is the body of work I'm working on now. So I've been invited to do a portrait of David Driscoll for the Driscoll Center. Yeah. That's going to be unveiled at his celebration of life on campus this April. And so that is the kind of center of a body of work that I'm doing called Opener of the Way. And it's about people who open the way in one way or another. So what I'll do is I'm going to stop the share and let you see. I'll talk to you about two of the pieces in that body of work. One is this behind me, which is a Robeson. This is a portrait of Paul Robeson as Toussaint Louverture in a movie called The Black Jacobins, which was never created. So C.L.R. James, who wrote the book The Black Jacobins, which is like the definitive history of the Haitian Revolution, he wanted to make a movie and he wanted Robeson to star in it. And so this is a poster from alternate reality in which the movie happened. It did not happen. And it had to be, it's in French because I imagine that they couldn't make it in America. They had to make it in France. And so what I'm doing with this body of work is kind of playing with time and space a little bit, right? So what I'm doing is kind of challenging. It's also homage to Charles White. This is kind of based on a study that Robeson did for a mural of Charles White that's at Hampton University. Well, it's not a mural of, it's of all Black heroes, but Robeson is in it. And the other project that I'll just talk about briefly is, well, there's a number of pieces that I'm doing for that body of work that I don't have time to talk about, but they've all required a lot of work. I'll show you one here. This wasn't what I was gonna show you, but since I have my book, Bob Marley. I did not wanna do Bob Marley, okay? Because does the world need another picture of Bob Marley? The answer is yes, it does. So my brother-in-law wanted me to do him. And I said, oh, just like Prince, I tried to get out of it. It's an artist that I look up to a great deal that wanted me to do Prince for him. So it's a big honor to do it. But I was like, oh, let me do this person. Let me do that person because I have to have something to add to the conversation if I'm going to do it. You know, the world doesn't need another picture of Bob Marley. The world doesn't need another picture of Prince. You know what? I have to figure out something that people are missing, you know? And so I feel like I did with the Prince. And I could talk about it a lot more, but we don't have time. But basically that's not what I would want. It's what Prince would want, you know? So I talked to people who knew him, you know, I studied him, read interviews, everything. And then about halfway through the process, I realized why he wanted me to do Prince, because he was a special person. You know, it wasn't, I always liked the music, but I didn't appreciate it on another level, right? And so, I cut that, but I'll say one more thing before I have to go to Q&A. Since you guys are interested in public art, I'm also doing a piece of public art, which is, and it's also in collaboration with young people too. So this is in Louisville, and to make a long story short, money was raised. Well, a teacher won, teacher of the year in the state of Kentucky, right? And instead of taking the money, the prize money, she said, I want to pay for the kids in this school to be able to go to DC for a trip. And it promised to be like a life-changing trip for some people that had never left town, right? And my friend Ed Lee, who's a chef, found out about it and he put money with it so more kids could go, not just those few. And then other people found out, like United Way and different people, and he put more money with it so more kids could go, to the point where the whole grade could go. And then the pandemic hit. So the trip is dashed. And so Ed reached out to me and said, well, I want you to come up with something that we can do anyway, something the kids can do, something artistic. And I said, okay. And I thought about it and we talked about it. And I said, well, I don't want to take any money from the kids' DC budget, right? So if we can do it some other way, yes. And we've determined to do it another way without touching that. So maybe they can go next year, whatever. But the school is called the Du Bois Academy in Louisville. And it's kind of like a little Morehouse. It's all male. It's almost all African-American male. And it's a middle school. And so Ed said, you know, as these monuments are coming down to Confederacy and stuff, we need some monuments to people who really should have monuments, like a Du Bois, for example. And so we settled on an idea of doing a Du Bois, a monument to Du Bois. And what I'm gonna do is, so there's actually gonna be two works of art. There's gonna be a collage. So all the kids, I'm working with the AP art kids at the school. They're gonna send me things that they've drawn, snapshot, family photo, any piece of material that they wanna submit for consideration for the collage. And then I'm gonna do, this is the sketch for the collage. Can you guys see that? And so this is, I could talk a lot about it, but I just wanna say, this is a very young Du Bois. We've never seen him this way because he lived to be very old and he's always depicted as an old man. And what is the reason I wanted to do this, if you notice, I do a lot of times famous people before they were so-called famous to show kids that they were intergalactic before anybody ever knew their name, and you might be too. And so the kids are into, you know, they're into anime and graphic novels. And so I wanted to do it in him in an age that resonated with them, not as an old man, and also in a style that would resonate with them. So this is a, you know, very, you know, energetic style, let's say. And I'll just say one more thing about it, which is that he has this goatee here, which he only had when he was an older man. He never had it when he was a young man. And the reason he had the goatee, I figured out, is that he was, it was to show Afro-Asian solidarity. It was to show Afro-Asian solidarity. And during the Q&A, I'll be able to look up and show you a picture of Du Bois. I have a book on the subject that has Du Bois with a bunch of Japanese guys. And this is a revelation or understanding that he had later in life, but I applied it to him at that youthful age. So at this point, let's go ahead and have the Q&A. And
there was one question that came super early, wondering if you use the actual archived elements in your collages, or are these photocopies or color photocopies, or are they actual archived ephemera that you use in your collages?
Good question. And the answer is both. They are, and I'm always having this debate with myself or conversation about what has to be sacrificed for it, for the piece to work, right? And sometimes the real thing has to go, and sometimes it doesn't. And sometimes things have to be preserved. But the interesting thing about it, there's sometimes something different about the real thing. So I have a replica of a piece of a flyer from the 60s. I made a replica of it. It's identical. I put it in the collage. It wasn't the same. Even though it looks exactly the same, it wasn't the same. And so I had to put the real thing in. It was calling for the real thing. And you know, someone pointed out to me that, well, it'll probably be conserved better because it's in the painting. You see? I'm just gonna share with you something else, which I just finished, the most recent print I just finished, which is Muhammad Ali. Again, a youthful Muhammad Ali, and the title of the print is, I'm America, I'm the part you won't recognize. Can you see that? Okay, so go ahead. Next question. Just knocking them out here.
I wanted to thank you for, you know, just showing us your process. grateful to have seen how you transform space with your art. And I wanted to, I liked the Toussaint piece that had the raft of Medusa as one of the collaged images, because I find that story always so interesting. You know, how at the top of the painting, that's a person of African descent waving that tattered flag. So I thought that was very unique manner of putting that within the.
Yeah, well, you picked up on that. You know, I try to have layers of layers on all my pieces. You know, I'm trying to have, you know, there's some people that appreciate the work just on a graphic, just design level or whatever. Then there's some people that, you know, understand the clippings and all the significance of the materials in the piece. But then there's another level that's just the energetic level that people don't understand at all, but they don't realize that the artwork is irradiating them one way or the other. Everything is irradiating them one way or the other. And so I'm focused on that part of it as well.
Imar, you have another question. How do color or texture contribute to the symbolism in your mixed media work?
How do color or texture contribute to the symbolism?
Yep.
Well, greatly. it's a lot of thought that goes into them. It's a lot, you know, some are almost, have no line work and only color. Like if you look at the, I mean, you can check it out again later, but the Josephine Baker one, there's no line work on it at all. It's just color, you know? Whereas some, and some are kind of austere in the palette, you know, and that's what I did with the Prince one. I made it kind of quiet, whereas most of my stuff is really not quiet. You know, I made that one in particular really, really quiet because, like I said, I'm still back on Purple Rain, but that's not where he was. You see, this is what, if Prince were alive, and we can only speculate, right? But this, I feel that he would like this, because this is how he presented himself to the world at the end of his life.
Annabelle, do you want to read off the next two? We have some good questions coming in.
Yeah, so we have one question. Where do you search for your collage images, more specifically the historic images you may not find in a magazine?
Everywhere, you know, I have, if I were to turn the camera around in here, you'll just see piles of just everything, you know, detritus, you know, books, magazines, sometimes people give me things now that they know that this is the stuff that I'm into. Sometimes I might just find things. Sometimes I might create things. I'm using, you know, for the first time, I'm using my screen print material as collage material as well. So I'm always trying to challenge myself in one way or the other. And we have a lot of questions and comments here.
Yeah. I just want
to thank everyone. You know, I know I'm running out of time, so I don't want to fail to have a chance to thank everyone for watching this. And I see many of my collectors of my work. I see Juanita and Mel Hardy are on the call, their comments and thank you. I see Heather Pope is there. And this is dangerous because I'm flipping through it so fast. I know I'm gonna miss people, but, and there's a lot of people with the same name. A lot of Melissa is.
Yeah, I shared a link to Crew earlier, and I think that's why my name is on, but anywhere you see the multiple Melissas, those are members of Studio Crew.
Okay.
So if any Studio Crew, you have a question, just open up mic or put it in the chat. Although I do see a really great question from Nicole. Annabelle, did you want to read that question from Nicole?
Yeah. Yeah, Nicole asks, do you have a blog or print that explains more about your choice of clippings and the importance they play in each of your pieces?
No, I don't. Like, basically, if you have to, this is just me talking, right? If I need to put a little book next to the painting for it to make sense and the painting is not working, you know, like you are supposed to get what you get out of it, you know? And, you know, what I wish that you could see them more closely, because, you know, it might, you can't really appreciate them from a distance like this. You know what I have, I think I still have 3 minutes, don't I?
Yeah.
Okay, so what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna play something that gives you like details.
I want to break
that gives you details of this is okay, let me share this with you guys. Because you get to see a piece close up, which I haven't really been able to do.
We find ourselves with this portrait of Lyman T. Johnson made by his grandson, Imar Hutchins. Is all that developed out of a conversation about a year ago between Mr. Hutchins and President Capilouto about ways of participating in this 70th commemoration, when Mr. Hutchins revealed to the president that he was indeed a practicing artist and had been doing portraits of prominent African Americans, as well as had done portraits of his grandfather, which often used historical imagery as well as hate mail that his grandfather had received. The idea sort of got launched to try to figure out a way to involve Imar in this process, which led to the thought of commissioning him to make a portrait of Lyman T. Johnson, which would eventually be housed in the residence hall that's named after him. He did research on his grandfather's archive, tried to figure out what is the right approach. I think obviously settled in on a thought, which is a collage portrait of his grandfather, the way he works, and this is very indicative of Imar's portraits in general, but spent time looking for specific data, letters, archival material that could get incorporated into this. It just arrived at the Art Museum the other day. It will be presented to the campus and community on Friday. Then it will come back to the museum to be on view as a sort of special opportunity till early December. Goes off to Louisville for an exhibition that Imar's having at the Muhammad Ali Center, and then will come back to campus and be installed in the residence hall.
Well, Imar, thank you so much for your talk today. Again, yes, we had some really lovely comments. Zami, you had some wonderful comments too. I do want to share his last one. He says that he thinks in many ways you embody the artist as an archivist, both in your process of creating and how you draw out perspectives and emotions from those who view the work. Again, we just want to thank you for being here and sharing with us your process and your research.
Oh, thank you. And let me say one thing to answer the question about the kids in Kentucky. We are doing a project together. They're doing their own collage portraits and I'm doing the big Du Bois. And we're going to have a special exhibition at the Speed Museum of their work and mine in May.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you, Melissa. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. So at this point, John, would you like to go ahead and share your presentation? And we'll give him a few minutes to do that. And I'm going to introduce John in just a couple minutes. You get lots of thank yous, Imar. All right, thanks so much, John. So I'm gonna go ahead and introduce John Ortiz draws his inspiration from a love of diverse art and design. Growing up in New York City, he was introduced to graffiti at a young age. His approach to the creative process, combined with a keen interest in abstract expressionism, is showcased in his mixed media art, printmaking, and commercial design. With his letter-based designs and murals, John has been able to showcase a variety of typographic studies through mediums like acrylic, spray paint, and chalk. John's work has been featured in Pyramid Atlantic's exhibition, Hello, My Name Is, DC2 Standing Rock's DC Artists in Solidarity with Standing Rock, and In Response, Conversations Between Emerging Artists and Contemporary Work from the CAP Collection at the University of Maryland Stamp Gallery. His recent print, In Your Name We Rise, George Floyd, which was part of the We Stand Pyramid Atlantic project, was recently added to the ephemera collection of the National Portrait Gallery, the Library of Congress, the Smithsonian Archives, and the National Museum of African American History and Culture. Please give a warm welcome to John.
Hello, hello. I just want to make sure everyone, can you hear me well?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, cool. Thank you so much, Melissa, for having me. Everyone that's tuned in, I appreciate you all kind of sharing this virtual space with me. Kind of like Imar was saying, it was just, I have so many images and so many things I can talk about. And so I feel like I can go for well over 45 minutes, 2 hours, 3 hours, but I tried to narrow it all down in this one presentation as far as the type of work that I do. But I also wanted to kind of share a combination of things, because for me, I feel like it's a balance between printmaking and freelance work. I also am an artist for Trader Joe's, so I do a lot of commercial design work with them. And then also having worked with and still working with a nonprofit organization in DC called Words, Beats, and Life. So I kind of worked with it chronologically as far as the presentation goes, but of course I'll probably be jumping back and forth to different things. And so I kind of wanted to start off with influences and what's kind of gotten me here artistically. Graffiti. It's a big thing I've been into since I was young. I just loved it as far as like color schemes and styles and artists. And I included Subway Art, which is I think one of the books that I first saw that kind of like turned me on to all this as far as like this form of art. And so it was really intriguing, so I had to share that book. That's probably one of my favorites from my collection. To the right, I just quickly grabbed some photos of different artists like Picasso, Cubism. That style is also really interesting to me. Dale Chihuly, Glassblower. I remember the first time I saw him, his work, I was just blown away as far as all the colors that are involved in there. And then grabbed another photo that I had seen out in Seattle one time from Dale Chihuly, and Futuro 2000, who's also an OG graffiti writer, super influential, very abstract as far as the work goes. And I had the pleasure of meeting him in DC a couple of years ago. So yeah, I don't know if you see the tag on the right of the right page, but that was him right there. And you know, it's really nice to be able to meet people that you kind of like are fans of and idolize, because they actually take the time to talk to you and kind of like give you good conversations that are enlightening and also very insightful. So I just wanted to share some little pieces as far as like artwork that's been influential for me. I wish I could just probably list, you know, more and more slides in here of all of the artists, even my peers, you know, people around me currently that are super influential. But for early works, as far as experimentation, you can see these were just examples of pieces that I kind of played around with. And I feel like how Imar was mentioning in his presentation, you know, all artists have their own path. And it's like, it's a matter of figuring out what works for you, what doesn't. And experimentation, it's just trial and error. And some things you might experiment with, fast forward maybe 5 years later, you'll want to go back to it, which I still do sometimes in my studio. I'll just kind of like look through a portfolio and wonder if I could actually add something to it or not. And then I just leave it alone. But yeah, so this was just kind of like mixed media, stencil, spray paint. Also, there's, as far as like influences, hip hop, you know, just culture all around, huge for me. So I kind of put some of that in there. Again, a lot of spray paint, pen and ink, just a lot of just media work just going on. Some stuff I really didn't even know what I was doing. I was just trying to apply stuff to paper. And then school, Montgomery College. So I actually went to Montgomery College. I went to the Rockville campus and also the Silver Spring Tacoma campus. And that's where I kind of was introduced to printmaking, intaglio. And this print I actually found last week in the studio. So it was just a lot of like experimenting with acid baths and Shin Kole and different techniques. I'm glad I found it. I'm glad, you know, I still keep some of this around. Enameling, another thing that I was fascinated with, and one day hopefully I'll go back to it and just kind of play around with it some more. University of Maryland, College Park. So here I feel like I kind of graduated a little bit as far as printmaking goes, because when I was taking a focus in studio art and specifically with printmaking, screen printing, I learned different techniques, and also I was kind of pushed into outside of my comfort zone, which, you know, I always feel like is a good thing. It's never a bad thing, especially if you're pushed in certain ways, because you just come up with different things. So on the left, I have prints, and you can kind of see two hands as a reference as far as the scale goes. These screen prints were actually used with bleach and also large format inkjet printers. And the actual patterns that were within the prints were actually brush strokes that I kind of magnified in Photoshop. And so when I printed them on the paper, it came out a certain way, like a pattern. And then on the right hand side, you can see I'm just messing around using watercolor for screen printing. Again, using references as far as like trains, because, you know, I love seeing freights and steel and all that type of stuff getting painted, and just like in general, the structure and design. So I just wanted to mess around with a different type of medium when it came to screen printing. And again, still in University of Maryland, I think what really helped me as far as being studying screen printing was that my professor always encouraged me as far as, you know, one of the things for me was loving spray paint and aerosol just in general. And he encouraged me to use that in my work. And so when I learned that I could kind of utilize and take those type of elements and put them into a fine arts aspect, it kind of lit a bulb in my head. And I was just thinking like, you know, the opportunities and the things I could do to experiment with it. And, you know, I'm still glad, again, this is another example of prints that I have to this day, which actually is kind of nice to see. It's refreshing, and it's something that, you know, I'd love to experiment more with, maybe on a larger scale. And as far as printing more, I have to say one artist that maybe some of you are familiar with, Matthew McLaughlin. He was one person who encouraged me to take part in SGCI, which is actually a printmakers conference. And that year, while I was still in school, it was going on in Portland. And so I took the opportunity and I flew out there and made these prints for a portfolio exchange. But even doing something like that just blew me away, because I was able to meet so many artists and connect with them in different ways and see all types of work that I didn't even know you could do. So again, it was just one of those things that was really helpful and kind of opened up my eyes. And then these are some other examples of work. Kind of experimented again with screen printing, going in by hand, spray paint, and just kind of working with like depth, push and pull with different colors and seeing how they felt. And then this piece I did also while I was at Maryland, and this was actually at the Stamp Gallery. And this was around the time where they had, I did this piece, and I remember it was the time where Freddie Gray had died, and all those articles you see in the piece, in the MLK piece, were actually articles, because I remember I collected articles from Baltimore, all newspapers. So the background is actually all clippings that I kind of wheat pasted to the back. And then from there, I kind of built up and layered. And, you know, the reason why I put MLK on there was because the last time there was any sort of reaction, voice coming from Baltimore after something like that was when MLK was killed. So I thought that connection, kind of like laying that on that piece, you know, was strong and meaningful in a certain way. But also, you know, I made sure like highlighting certain articles in certain placements so you can actually see them. So, you know, that was one of my last pieces at Maryland, but it was really nice to be able to contribute something like that, especially in the show there. Let's see, Trader Joe's. So one thing I have to say is getting my feet wet in general. Like, you know, while I was going to school, I actually started working for Trader Joe's and at Maryland. And for me, one thing that I appreciated about the company was that they were so flexible. I was going to school during the day, Monday through Friday, and then I was going to work at night. And when I had applied for the artist position, you know, I didn't know what to expect. And so the reason this is another example of like pieces that I've saved, because July 2013, these images, these illustrations that I put together, I had actually gone in to a listing for the position. And the manager had told me, you know, take a look around, get a feel of the store, see what kind of artwork we have, come up with some drafts, and then feel free to drop them off whenever you can. So I quickly went home, I drew these signs. And you know, it's something also nice to see, because you see where you started and where you've progressed. And no matter what, I'm always learning and I will never stop learning. And that's something that, like, you know, has always stuck with me. And I really appreciate just like connecting with artists there too. And so you can see these signs when I dropped them off. The reason why I put stress test equals time management was because when I went in for my interview, when they called me after seeing these images, they gave me a 6-foot chalkboard, 1 8x10 piece of paper, and 1 4x6 piece of paper. And they gave me coconut water. They gave me a can of capers and a can of pineapple salsa. And they said, we want the coconut water on the 6-foot board. We want the pineapple salsa on the 8x10 sheet. And we want the capers on the 4x6 sheet. And they gave me Prisma markers and they gave me Posca markers. And I think me having some experience just being into drawing, illustration, graffiti, all that type of stuff, I felt comfortable. But I also realized, like, when they said you have 1 hour, I kind of muted them. And I started focusing on what I needed to take care of first. I don't unfortunately have any pictures of like the board or any of that, but just to give you an idea, that that was their interview. And so I expected just to sit down and be one-on-one and kind of talk back and forth. But, you know, I think I did a good job, because fast forward, I'm still with the company 7 years, and I've gone from different stores, and I can keep going. And, you know, just to show you some examples of different locations, I started in Clarendon in Arlington, Virginia. And not too long after, I had transferred over to the U Street store when they had actually, they weren't even open yet, but I was still kind of getting my feet wet in the company, but working with artists that, you know, you can say they're like regional artists. They take the lead on these projects as far as store openings. I've definitely learned a lot. And so they gave me like little projects, you know, foam core cutouts, just kind of promoting the opening of the store. And for me, I was just like super excited to work on something like that. And so I just remember like that display that you see on U Street. It's always being switched out different times of the year. But I thought that was really cool just to see something like that. And shelf signs for the dairy section of the store. I'm not sure if anyone's familiar, but every single store has their own set of in-house artists, and every single sign in the stores, the chalkboards, the murals, everything's done by the artists that are usually from that store or maybe in the region. And so this was a fun project for me as far as recreating templates that were used in the dairy section. Let's see. And then this was also for the U Street location. So I drew up these templates that were used for clip strips, like different sections of the store. But a nice thing that we try to do is in every location, we kind of try to cater and work with the neighborhood, the community. And so, you know, I wanted to bring some music into that as far as like personality with the templates. And then this is just an example of something simple, small, but like maybe dimensions, maybe like 4x11, 4x12, but a process as far as creating a chalkboard. Again, something that has been helpful as far as penmanship and color schemes and style, I think, is just practice and also learning and being into different art forms that kind of play in that aspect of thinking about color schemes and how things pop when you see one color compared to another. This was also for the U Street store before they opened. I don't know if anyone is familiar with their Fearless flyer, but they come out maybe about once a month. And the majority of the time, it's just like a little piece of newspaper, little article that's sent out through the mail, highlighting different items. So we kind of went with like a steampunk theme here. So that's what I kind of put together in that board. And so in all the stores, there's usually a merchandising team. And so with the teams, they usually kind of get together and see what items work for what time of the year. And so we'll kind of coordinate with them to see how to put together the displays. And yeah, again, it's focusing on the color scheme, the product, highlighting the price, value added. I don't know if you can see like even the value added, like crunchy, sweet, nutty cereal made from whole grain oats, like stuff like that. You know, these boards were old, but like even something like that, I kind of like practiced and kept going. And I have to tell you, even when I first started, the one number, I never thought I would have trouble with this, but the one number that always gave me difficulty was the number 9. But, you know, now I'm okay with it. Me and the number 9 are cool. So let's see. There's another example. Popcorn and a pickle. Picnic pleasers. So yeah, again, this is just another example of like being able to, one, having the pleasure to work with people who give you that kind of, one, they're very art oriented, and they also really want you to work. And they basically just really appreciate what you can bring to the table, and also even encourage you as far as different ways of how you can apply a graphic to a certain end cap or a certain product. So yeah, this is another thing that was kind of like, not so much planned. I just kind of went with it, and I just created these letters and highlighted them and gave it that kind of fun little picnic colors, the red and white. And yeah, let's see, a couple more I'll show you. I went through a lot of pictures because I tend to take these and hold on to them, and I felt like I just wanted to share like a variety of like colors and designs and show you how I'm able to kind of like highlight certain things in the store, and also just how like my experience in general, as far as like being an artist, kind of growing into like this whole thing as far as like lettering, the art of lettering and sign painting, how it all comes together. So these are just some seasonal displays over the years that I kind of grabbed. And you can see for the fall, I just kind of stuck with like a orange type theme. Holiday treats. This one I had fun with, just kind of messing around with like a little bit of 3D and highlighting some of the stuff like the candy canes and the peppermints. Let's see. Again, I kind of threw in more seasonal signs just to kind of give you the feel of the stuff that we work on throughout the year. So this right here was actually done 2-3 weeks ago. And so one big thing was that one material we used to work with was foam core, but as far as it not being environmentally friendly, you know, they kind of encouraged us to get creative to see what else we could use. So these, the trains and the cars, we thought it would be fun to kind of put these together. And so we actually used cardboard for all of this. The thing was, you know, if it was in the frozen section, people were going to see it from both sides, meaning we had to do double the work. But I think it was fun just being able to put it together. And my one coworker, he's like a train enthusiast, and so he was kind of focused on taking care of the cars, and I took care of the products because I thought tying that in would be kind of fun. So what I did was I took seasonal products and I kind of created them into train cars and painted them all by hand. And so, you know, highlighting some seasonal items. I thought it was fun. It was kind of clever. And I think creating this kind of gives us more opportunity for next year to create more cars and add on and keep going down the frozen section. This too was one I did last week. I thought it was kind of funny. I don't know if anyone, Snoop Dogg, you know, he just came out with a wine with a company called 19 Crimes, but I kind of did a little nod to his first album, which I listened to. So I kind of threw that in there. So just having fun. And this is kind of another display we put together at the Capitol Hill location. And so it's kind of taking some of the products and using as the ornaments. And you can see one of the chalkboards in the bottom that says, "'Tis the season." So I put that together. And in the top, in the background, I don't know if you can see, it looks like kind of like a tower going up, an installation that says Trader Joe's Market, Pasadena, California. So that's something that I put together for the opening of the Capitol Hill store. And that in itself was probably at the time the biggest project for me. So I was kind of thinking of like the depth and also the measurements and the scale and cutting everything out by hand. So all those letters that you see were all foam core at the time that I cut out by hand. I spray painted everything, created a little bit of gradient as a fade to go on some of the backings. And that's it when it was installed right before the store opened. Another sign for the restrooms in Capitol Hill. And then this was last year for the Glover Park location, which is opened in September. And so that was one of the projects I got to work on. And as you're leaving, when you're taking the elevator, you can see this like flying, we call him a wolf man, but he's just this one character that they tend to use. So I was able to put something on there, which was kind of nice, different, but fun. And then we were told, as far as the front of the store, a lot of times on that location on Wisconsin Avenue, customers tend to drive by and don't even know where the store is. And so we had to come up with something to actually put on the front of the store. And I pretty much assisted on this project. The lead artist, he kind of came up with the design and the layout. But again, this is something that we were able to put together and something that we were comfortable with because we used spray paint, we used acrylic, just brushes for outlines. And so the fact that we were something that we're familiar with and comfortable with, I mean, the time went by like that, as far as taking care of it. But it's fun because now definitely those bright colors in that pineapple one, a lot of times people think of it as a sign of welcoming, but also like the bright colors can catch your eye as you're driving by. And if you can see in the last picture, there's another logo in the vestibule. So that's another one I put up. And then this one, jumping to this one I actually painted last week in the parking lot of Capitol Hill. And so I had painted about 2 years ago, a different mural on one other wall. But recently they had asked as far as being able to put something on this wall as you're leaving the store. So it's kind of like thanking the customer as they're leaving. But I also wanted to keep the design, the colors cohesive with the other wall that we painted. And so I did this one. It was about 4 days, but it was just kind of like planned out. Unfortunately, this one was all by paintbrush. But I think the planning of it all helped out. And kind of thinking about the sketches and designs that I put together when I first applied for the project and then for the company. And now fast forward to see like the things that I'm doing. I feel like I've come a long way. And like I said, just learning, having a better understanding of how things work as far as like commercial design. Another thing, that I'm big on, but also I feel like everything's connected in one way or another, was words, beats, and life. And while I was finished school and I was more involved with Trader Joe's at the time, I saw an internship for words, beats, and life. And I remember I had applied to it, the position. And I'll never forget the day of, and I don't think I've told this to the director, but I remember the day of the interview, for some reason, I just had a doubt. And I just felt like, you know, I don't know, maybe this isn't for me. Maybe I shouldn't even try to go into the interview. And I went in and it was just like a really, a good talk. And again, this was one of those interviews that were kind of like not really, tell me a little bit about yourself. And da da da. It was questions like name me 2 to 3 graffiti documentaries and name me 2 to 3 graffiti books. And that was just something that came like right out of my head and something that I felt like I was just really comfortable with. And so with Words, Beats, and Life, I started off as an intern and really just kind of assisting the instructors and just seeing what they need, also working with kids, the students in the evenings. But eventually I became an academy manager. So I was kind of overseeing all the classes that were going on. And then after that, I was also teaching. And then after that, I also got involved with college prep material. So it was just different aspects, different outlets that I was involved with Words, Beats, and Life, and still am. But I think this mural I kind of threw in there because it was something that I had a lot of fun with. And this was the original sketch that I put together for it. And the nice thing is that they, you know, a lot of the students or apprentices were able to get involved with it, which is nice because not only were they helping, but we also had people from the community come and help. And so it was one of those things where, you know, and the spray paint was non-toxic, by the way. But it was nice to have people from the community ask, want to take part in this event. I'm just going to fast forward because I was just seeing the time. But this was another class. This is when I first started and I was interning. And this was a class that I thought was fun. Stenciling with Kate DeCiccio. And we were just working with layers as far as like midtones and highlights and, you know, some things that you just kind of, I ever didn't really even think of, but after kind of like getting a better understanding, cutting these out and seeing how they work. One fun project we did was we used a product from Trader Joe's, which were gummy bears. And so I brought the kids gummy bears. And so I felt like they were kind of on a sugar rush, but they really enjoyed the whole project. And so what we did was we created these gummy bears and I kind of tied it in and brought it actually installed at the U Street location. And so it's kind of fun because they kind of have their own little addition to that store. So as you're walking and leaving the store, you'll see it. But I also kind of wanted to share Words, Beats, and Life, you know, the organization at the same time, and kind of spread that word with everyone. So a little bit of screen printing. I had fun being able to work with students as far as doing workshops, even taking some students to University of Maryland for screen printing. This was a part of their Chinatown block party. So we would have different events like printing on t-shirts, printing on posters. This was an event, and this was another like highlight for me. A documentary called Style Wars. There's a graffiti writer named Mayor139, and he has like this one key role, but it was really nice to see him at this event that we had hosted and being able to have a 30-minute conversation with him was priceless. And to the right is one of his sculptures. So he had brought several sculptures to show. But yeah, definitely fun. This was a mural I painted in Capitol Hill last year with them. And this one was a fun project, 2 days, stressful, but fun nonetheless. Pyramid Atlantic. So as Melissa said, you know, we're all a part of Pyramid Atlantic. We all have our private studios there. So being at Pyramid, it's helped me in different ways. I heard about it when I was in school. I heard about it when I worked at Plaza at one point. You know, I would meet the director and board members and different artists and a friend who had a residency. So he kind of introduced me. And so there it's kind of falls with like also the freelance that I do because I'm also working out of that studio. And so these are just different pieces of work as far as screen printing goes. And these were more mixed media sign painting pieces for Pyramid's 10x10 show. And this was a print from the We Stand campaign that went on earlier this year. So I had actually created the design and volunteers, including I think Melissa had printed it up as well. And then this was a recent print that I did. We Need Change, which was a fun piece to do. But again, also I kind of want to, as far as style and colors and all that stuff, I kind of wanted to just kind of remind how these things come together as far as my influences and the work that I've been doing with Trader Joe's and working with Words, Beats, and Life and meeting different artists and kind of building on the style. I feel like it's always, like I said, trial and error, and there's always room for growth and kind of figuring out, you know, what path it is you want to take and a balancing act. I'm definitely balancing these things, and sometimes one side might feel heavier than the other, but you know, it's definitely something worth going through and worth doing. And so these are just kind of like work in progress pics of that print. Hand painted directional signs for Pyramid Atlantic. So all of these I did just by hand with one shot paint. And then the slides that are coming up, you'll also see more murals and commercial work as well. This is another example as far as about 2 years ago, I spoke at UDC, University of District of Columbia, at their production design class. And so I was kind of presenting them my work, what it is that I do specifically. And I kind of also wanted to kind of bring them in with an activity. And so at the time when I was working at the Capitol Hill store, I thought there was a perfect space that could use some artwork. And so I kind of wanted them to feel free to kind of sketch letters out and also kind of take part in cutting and everything. And so I had spray painted the background the day before, but then I brought in these two foam core pieces. They weren't sure what we were gonna do, but it was nice to see how involved they were and also being able to share that with them. Cause after we were done, I kind of cut them all out and I put it on display with like another frame. So it's kind of like the Words, Beats, and Life project where the kids worked on gummy bears, and I installed that at the U Street store. And then this project from the students from UDC, and their work is still in the Capitol Hill store, which is cool to see. Let's see, a couple of murals. This is back in 2016. And I had actually been asked to paint a mural in a restaurant, a Peruvian restaurant. And that year I'd actually just come back from Peru. So it was like fresh on my mind and something that, you know, I was definitely looking forward to and felt, you know, excited about. So these are just some progress pics. This is Phillips Seafood at the BWI airport. This one painted 3 years ago. This one was a little tough because of the brick, and sometimes you might not think about certain things like that, but the grooves and everything is just takes time, but it was fun to work on. And sometimes I think like, it's kind of like Trader Joe's. Some people are surprised that there's artists that are at the store creating all these signs and focusing on these details. So I'm not sure how many people walk into a restaurant or into a store and really kind of take a look at certain things and the people behind it. Broccoli City Festival. So I took part in this event 2 years ago, and we were given three panels. And so I just thought it was another fun event to be a part of. Music, good weather, other artists, friends. And so this was one. I felt like also it was, you know, good opportunity to kind of put some of these messages out there. And, you know, it was I feel like any time is appropriate. You can always do that. And so I felt like, you know, being able to contribute and apply some of these things into a space like this was good, was nice. And then these were some other works. The work on the right, I actually had painted at the event, but also contributed to a fundraiser. And so that was a mixed media piece. This one I painted last year, actually right next to Pyramid Atlantic in Hyattsville at the mayor's office. So this was a interesting project to work with, but again, kind of tying in like abstract expressionism and style and funk, like kind of like thinking Futura-like and stuff like that. Bandit Taco, they opened up two locations, U Street and Tenleytown. So even it's just experiencing and playing with these mediums and painting on these surfaces. Record Exchange in Silver Spring, I did some work for them. Did some canvases, spray paint. So you can see in the storefront as well. And then recently they reached out as far as some signs for them. So I kind of created these, keeping in mind like the color schemes and also kind of some fun with the messages as well. And then earlier this year, I painted the front of Material Things. This is Frank Rosario, Katie Aldworth family. So I had the pleasure of painting the front of this, their storefront for them. That was a fun project, hot, but nonetheless, it was a fun thing to work on. And I think I'm almost done. This is the one thing I also painted downtown in Chinatown through Paints Institute in downtown DC. But it was a last minute thing, but I was glad I was able to go out there and just kind of apply something to this storefront. And that's it. This was one of those pieces we put together in Capitol Hill. And I thought it was interesting because it's like, you know, your vision, what you see, what you do. And so I always remembered your vision, your talent, use it. You know, it's a nice tool, it's a strong tool too. And I think that's it. Yeah.
Thanks so much, John.
No problem.
I just want to open it up to questions. You got a lot of compliments, lots of bravo.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I was just kind of trying to fly through the slides, but hey, I hope okay. it was okay.
Hey, oh, it was wonderful. You had a lot of good compliments for chat while you were talking. So Dame said, it's cool how we are all familiar with your work at TJ's in some degree before this meeting. Your work is everywhere, which is awesome. We had an earlier question from Lisa, I believe, asking about where some of the work from Trader Joe's goes after, you know, it's finished in terms of the advertising period. So what happens to it after that?
Yeah, no, that's a good question. I think there are some things that we put together as far as seasonal items, seasonal displays that we actually do our best to save. So we have storage units or storage in the stores, and we try to save them. If not, maybe just reusing whatever material it was painted on, just kind of like work with it again somehow. But for the most part, there's a lot of installations, larger pieces that usually will stay around for years and years. But the seasonal items we'll hold on to. So, you know, I was hanging up snowflakes the other day and all this stuff from last year. So we tend to keep those.
Anne had a question about time management. She said, how do you think about the way you use your time?
Well, I think I try to think of what's my priority, what's number one. But of course I'm human, like I just will forget some things but I do my best to think about prioritizing certain things, what's most important. and then what can go after that, and then figuring out how much time I have, and if I, and realistically, if I can get something done within that amount of time. So it's kind of also understanding that you can't always get everything done in a certain amount of time, but as long as you prioritize, I think that's really an important way to look at it.
Any other questions from folks? And also feel free to open up your mic if you don't want to chat.
John, is there ever a graphic style or font that you've created for Trader Joe's that they ask you or encourage you not to use in your personal artwork?
No, I think that there's a lot of times it's anything that I'll work on. Sometimes I'll just kind of sketch it out and kind of present it to see if like, if it's cool, if that's something I can use. There's been moments where, you know, we come up with something, but it just doesn't work for certain reasons. So we might have to kind of scratch the idea or, you know, kind of tweak it a little bit. But for the most part, I think just kind of checking in and making sure that certain fonts work for a certain display is a good thing. But I don't think I've run into a problem where they had an issue where I couldn't use certain things. But like I said, we had to tweak certain boards before for certain reasons.
I'm curious how big the team of artists is that you work with at Trader Joe's. And also, I don't know if you know anything about how it works in other communities, if they have a policy of hiring local artists, and how many people they employ.
As far as artists go, so I feel like, so when I started, you know, I worked with two other artists, and those two artists are still working for the company. One I'm still working with to this time, learned a lot from him actually. I think it's just a matter of openings. If there's a certain store that's actually looking for an artist, you know, there's always opportunity. It's just a matter of applying and kind of working your way into it. Because there's different things, like I said, that before, like with time management and different things, you kind of got to get used to. So I think as far as the team goes, most stores have anywhere between 2 to 3 artists. Mm-hmm. And I think over time, you kind of know who's working at which store, but not always. Some stores might have 1 or 2 artists and kind of rotate. So when I was at the Capitol Hill store last week, I met one person who had just started at the beginning of like the pandemic. And so everything was new to her. So I was kind of talking with her for a little bit. So it's kind of, I would say it's a pretty small community, but I mean, it's very, they're very open as far as like the talent that you bring.
Hey, Jim.
Go ahead.
How you doing?
Yes.
I love you.
How are you?
Doing good, man. Well, I'm proud to be your next door neighbor. Our studios are next door to each other.
Yeah.
But I love your story about the interview at Trader Joe's, and how here's a piece of paper, here's a chalkboard, here's this. You have an hour, and like I think that the number one, well, maybe the number one thing that an artist has to be able to do is to execute. Like you have to be able to execute. And totally. So that's something like when people talk about artists and like how you picked up, you repeated what I said about there's no one way or right way to do it. But like at the end of the day, the artist has to be able to execute. And so the person who can, you know, I love it because there's no, you think you're going to be sitting there like, yes, I'm an organized person, a self-starter. And they're like, no, here's a piece of paper. And so you cannot go that far as an artist if you can't be relied upon to do whatever you say you're going to do, which is a kind of like a business-like type of attribute. But then that's not the stereotypical artist attribute, even though a successful artist has to be able to do that. Like if they, you know, hire you to do something that has to be done by a certain day, you don't do it, well, it's a big problem. And, you know, if you were going to have a exhibition somewhere and, you know, they're counting on you to do the work, you can't just say, oh, I didn't do it. You know,
I'll get to it next year or something.
Yeah. So I think that, you know, a good takeaway from this conversation is that, like, you know, if we're talking about demystifying what it is to be an artist, then, you know, part of it is just that there has to, what I hear from you is that you have to have a ability to, you know, cobble together, you know, different ways of living, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
and
everything's
done anyway.
Yeah.
And so like you have to kind of just dismiss whatever you imagined or show in movies and, you know, thinking the artist is like wearing black and listening to opera and drinking wine and just, just like you have some stereotype, but it doesn't exist. You know, like the real artist is the person that there's some, you know, famous artist, I can't remember who, back in the day that, you know, they were coming to, they were, somebody called a plumber and then this guy showed up, you know? And they're like, aren't you so-and-so? He's like, oh yeah, but you need your toilet fixed, right? You know, so it's like now people now would think, oh, well, that's not, you know, I'm not really an artist if I'm also a plumber, you know?
But yeah.
Which I can remember because it's a person that we've all heard of that I'm talking about. And they're like, this is, it's life, you know? It's not these delineations that people have believed themselves into. And so
That's
why, you know, you're flourishing with like in so many ways and coming up with all these cool things, you know, and just, you know, almost like attracting good stuff to you. Like even, you know,
you
doubted that interview and then, you know, ended up being like a great thing. You know, you didn't let that doubt say, you know, somebody else would have said, I'm just not going to go in there, you know, or whatever.
Yeah.
Or somebody else would have choked when it was time to like, you know, do these three things in an hour, you know?
Yeah. No, totally. And it's kind of like thinking about, you know, what people see as like someone to be an artist, like kind of cookie cutter in a certain way. But it's, you know, there's all these other things out there and it's just a matter of kind of like exploring, experimenting, being flexible and kind of putting yourself out there in certain ways. And like I had mentioned before, even if it's something that you're not comfortable with, you know, I've had to push myself internally, like saying, you know what, just do it, like, and see how that goes.
Right. Exactly. I mean, you have to, you mentioned always challenging yourself, you know, like I'm doing that too. I didn't finish the story, but basically the Du Bois thing I'm doing is going to be like a metal sculpture exterior thing where layers of steel, different colors.
Oh, wow. You know,
and I've already committed to building that monument there. And I've never done anything like that, you know? So I know I'm going to do it because I said I'm going to do it.
Right.
You know what I mean?
And it's sometimes that, like for me, like envisioning that, like, okay, by this time next week, I will already have done this, but I got to get into it. I got to do it. So
exactly.
Yeah. Taking those chances or just like going through with it.
Yeah. So. And it was also, you know, a joy to get you to collaborate on the Queen Brianna project, you know?
And, no, thank you. Thank you, for that. Really appreciate it.
Commonalities of our talks or of printmaking in general, that it's a democratic, you know, collaborative process in the first place. Like you're either you're making a sign that you want a a lot of people to see, or you may get something to hand out that you want people to get. So it's not as aloof as like, oh, you know, I'm a painter, you know, like that person with that mind can just be by themselves, but it's kind of like, oh, you know, the exposure unit is broken, but what you have to do is you put the little magnet in this spot when you do it and you expose it for longer.
So you put a little on.
Yeah. So it's like there's always this kind of dialogue that has to happen to make, you know, as you well know, Melissa, to make, you know, printmaking work. And I think people that do that tend to be more collaborative as artists. I mean, I see that with the murals and everything you're doing, the work you're doing at Trader Joe's. I mean, you found one of the few companies in America that values artists, you know? There's like one publication left.
That I know.
That's the New York, you know?
And I'm really grateful for it too, because it's like, you know, small world, the person that hired me, I'm still working with to this day. Right. And, you know, come from New York, same neighborhood or same part of New York, and just having these connections and building with people. And yeah, and being able to say that, like, I do this full time on top of everything else, and, you know, having different perks, benefits, stuff like that, you know, it's just like super grateful for this, for the opportunity to do that.
John, before we go, we just have a few more minutes. There was one really amazing question in chat I just wanted to pitch your way. It came from Aurelia, and she was asking, what course have you taken or professional development that helps you price your work? And also, do you have an artist contract for your public commissions that you share with the client? So some really great business related questions.
I think the first part of the question was, did I take any course on that?
Yeah, I think she might be talking about coursework or classes. And
like at Montgomery College or any of your other institutions, did you have these professional development courses for pricing work, and how do you go about that?
Yeah, so I think another really good question. I think it was just kind of for that. Unfortunately, you know, there aren't any classes that I know of that I could recommend, but it was just kind of experiences and learning and understanding what one project is compared to another, because, you know, one wall might not be the same dimension as another wall and scale and detail. And so there's a lot of things that I've learned that come into play. So it could be your time for production to create the work, your time to design the work, the materials behind it, and then also scale. So some walls could be small, some could be 3 stories high. And so it's a matter of kind of figuring out what works best for you and valuing your time, because, you know, understanding your worth and what you can provide and what you can bring, because, you know, it's your talent. And so that's what they're seeking, for you to kind of create and be able to share that with one, two people, a community, you know, wherever. But I think it's all, I kind of tend to treat it now like a case by case matter, because, you know, I can't give one quote to one client compared to another, because they might be asking for a completely different thing. And I've noticed that. I kind of feel like that's kind of like a theme or what it is. It's like, I don't usually fall into the exact same request, because one person would prefer me to use a certain type of medium or a certain type of effect compared to someone who just wants black and white letters, straight letters, mm-hmm. really simple. So it's all kind of like different and kind of feeling your way through it. And it was difficult at first. And I mean, you know, it's just a matter of kind of figuring those things out. But I would say definitely your time, you know, your value, your time, materials, production, design, all that come into play.
Thank you.
I hope I answered that.
Yeah. Covered that. You did. I thought it was an excellent answer. Don't undersell yourself when it comes to evaluating your work and labor as an artist. So I want to thank you again, John and Imar, for
coming
today. It was such a great talk. Again, I think, John, you said it's always a learning process, and I learned so much from the both of you today, and I hope others did as well. Such beautiful, amazing work. I mean, the amount of labor and skill that goes into all of the hand cutting, John, for example, with the work that you showed, and Imar, just incredible. And again, thank you again for joining us today.
No, thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Thank you for everyone tuning in.
Thank you, everyone.
Hey team, it's my job to just close us out. And I wanted to let you know that I put a couple of links in the chat. This Block Talk plus others are on the page that's linked there for Block Talks. We're so appreciative of this time to spend together to talk about a wide range of things and ask a bunch of questions. Thank you, thank you. Then I also want to let you know there's another link in there to our Arts on the Block year in review. So if you're curious about what we've been up to this year, click that link and you can see some of the things that have been going on. And super special thanks to Melissa for making our connections today and for the whole AOB team that was part of putting the event together. We appreciate you so much. And thanks everybody, have a great evening.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take care. Bye. Have a good night.
Bye.
Bye.